I'm Rod Slasher Breslau of GameSpot, and I'm here with id Software CEO Todd Hollinshead. Talk to me all about competitive gaming, esports, and Doom 3's new re-release with some added features. Let's start off with the new re-release for Doom 3. There's some new multiplayer features for console, for 360, and for PS3.
Yeah, that's right. So we're calling it the BFG edition because it includes everything that we shipped with the original Doom 3, plus the add-on Resurrection of Evil, plus Doom and Doom 2, and is on PC, PS3, and 360. So you'll get all the multiplayer from Doom and Doom 2, plus the Doom 3 stuff. Then you get the, you know, all the other content. Plus, we found the lost missions of what happened to Bravo Team, and you'll get to play through that as content that's never been seen before in Doom 3. And importantly, it's the PC experience from the original game on the consoles, and all three platforms are running at 60 frames a second, which when Doom 3 was originally released, it was the most we could get out of the hardware to run it at 30 frames a second. So it's a really cool update to a game that when you see it, even compared to today's stuff, with some of the little things we've done to up-res the textures and put a little more polygons in a model here or there, that still looks very competitive visually with all the games that you see at the show.
Now, with multiplayer being added to PS3 and kind of revived to the 360 market, do you think the console guys are going to maybe take the Doom 3 and the re-release and kind of play that a decent amount of multiplayer?
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, there's a whole PlayStation audience out there that has really never played a Doom game, because not just, you know, Doom 3, but we've had no Doom content for PlayStation players since, what, I guess it was maybe PS1 or with the master levels of Doom, or, you know, whatever we released there, going back to, like, literally when Sega was still producing consoles. So that was the last time that, you know, Sony PlayStation owners have been able to play a Doom game. So we think there's a market that we can reintroduce the franchise to.
Yeah, I mean, I remember those days, the Final Doom level. I feel like that was the last thing.
Final Doom was the last one.
Yeah. That was on PlayStation 1. So I hope that scene, you know, does revive with Doom 3. So I know we're not going to find anything about Doom 4, so I'm just going to totally leave that out. So to focus more on the competitive side and esports side, which is why I'm here, talk about Quake was kind of the original game that made esports what it was in the West, both in North America. How does id Software as a whole from the top level think about esports and professional gaming?
Well, we're fans of it. You know, we sort of get in the middle of it every year at QuakeCon, and, you know, put a lot of resources behind trying to pull off excellent tournaments every year. And in fact, you know, I think the Red Annihilation tournament with Thresh was like the first ever real pro tournament where, if anybody remembers till today, Carmack gave away one of his Ferraris to Thresh, and sort of he became like a celebrity as a result of that. And so I think it's true that we have launched a number of pro players' careers through playing our games. And, you know, for us, still to this day, the id philosophy is the best multiplayer games from a tournament basis and from a pro basis are ones where it is an even playing field and you basically compete on the basis of skill. And that's sort of like tapped out in terms of our advancement on it at Quake 3, and then was implemented again in Quake Live. And that has really been where our emphasis has been for the past 3 to 5 years, whereas we focused more on the single player with games like Rage, and the multiplayer implementation there was competitive but not so really pro deathmatch style, because we put the competition in vehicles. But these things have not left our mind. We do think about, you know, what it is that will come next, and these are things that, while we're not ready to talk about anything, they are things that are important to us, and we haven't, you know, sort of left that behind. It is something that we do see, whether it's with the innovations we made with Quake Live to sort of put it out there for free for everybody to play and then use that as the basis for our tournaments for QuakeCon, or whether it's for something we're going to do next, is that we still do, I mean, as I think the company is the inventor of deathmatch. I know there are people who say, oh, well, this was that before or whatever, but really, Quake-style deathmatch was the first of its ilk, and I still think that all games today still have an essence of that. They're a part of them, whether it's from Quake or whether it's a, you know, a tip here or there, or somebody's using something that we did. Yeah, even go over and talk to the guys at Activision with the stuff that they're doing. They're all like, you know, it was on the backs of stuff that you guys did, and Carmack and Abrash with the networking and all that stuff. So that really is a part of the company DNA. So we may not always get it perfect, but I don't think we'll ever give up on it. Obviously, we'd be fools if we didn't pay attention to what's going on in the industry, because you have to, you know, you have to keep an eye on what's going on so that you can keep up with it, and then hopefully, you know, take even a leap ahead of it when we're coming out with whatever is next. You know, we did put a lot of focus on that stuff with the Quake Live launch and all of that, and so we do feel like we have an entrant into that based on sort of the, you know, the Quake 3 DNA. But, you know, obviously there are, you know, we can't be all things to all people. It's not going to be an RTS. It's not necessarily going to have the same fan base in, you know, outside of North America as, say, some of the Blizzard stuff has, because, you know, they've been developing that for a long time and put a lot of investment in that, where for the type of games that we make aren't necessarily, they don't resonate as well in, say, you know, the Asian market, et cetera, where, you know, the StarCraft and stuff just, like, absolutely blew up in Korea, and then sort of the legacy is going forward with that. And I think that for us, probably to focus on something like that would really be a mistake, because that gets a little away from the core of what it is that we know the best. But what we do know is we do know how to make great games. We definitely know how to make great shooting games, and I will say that we have had our share of fun with the multiplayer side of it as well. And you know, we may have focused on the single player in the past, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that's all that we're going to do going forward.
Do you have any feelings about maybe the deathmatch genre and Quake getting smaller over time, and how to revive that?
I mean, I think that, you know, some people would probably say is, all right, well, then we weeded out all the people that we don't want to be playing with us anyway. But most of the pro players tend to play where the money is, and they tell us is they wish that, you know, that they could play Quake like that, but we haven't really sort of gone off and said, okay, well, we'll pay people to play our game. It's just been a philosophical thing with us, other than like, oh, if you want to come to QuakeCon and win it at a tournament, that's all fair. But, you know, yeah, it is on us to be able to try to and grow the community, and those are things that we want to see happen. Now, you know, whether that all goes into emphasis as Quake Live, or whether it's another Quake game down the road, or whether it's a part of another game or something like that, I mean, these are things that we sort of have to sort of, you know, cross as we get to these decision points, you know, and those are things that aren't necessarily like right in front of us. You know, we're not showing those games here.
How do you feel about the deathmatch genre as a whole kind of being overtaken by the realistic shooter, from Counter-Strike to Call of Duty to Battlefield, Medal of Honor, a list which never seems to end, where the deathmatch genre really has not been improved upon? Do you feel like developers are going too much away from the fake world where you could fly a million miles an hour and shoot rockets at people, and are focusing too much on realism?
Well, I mean, certainly the realism has been popular, and that's why, you know, a lot of people are playing it, and it's shown that, so that's encouraged companies to go and, you know, like, oh, well, they did it, they were successful, I want to do something like that, I want to be successful. And so I do think that there's room for innovation there, and I mean, I think that the guys that are making those games are, you know, feel the same way, and they're trying to do that, but there's a lot of games that are doing things that are similar, and so, you know, I do think that there's an opportunity there to do something that's different.
We've seen some developers actually put money directly into the leagues for prize money. Has there been any thought about directly putting money in from id or Bethesda into a prize pool for the different leagues themselves, or maybe even not just doing QuakeCon, but doing an entire world tour or a season?
Well, I mean, we've had a lot of discussions about how best to sort of leverage our efforts in those areas. And, you know, honestly, I think is you make the best game and then go from there. And, or, you try to stay true to your philosophy and don't, like, because you get into sort of a false trap of, like, okay, well, if I spend this and this will happen, and then maybe it does or maybe it doesn't. And so that's never really been something that has been sort of where we've wanted to spend our resources. But, you know, that doesn't mean that that's not something that we'd ever want to do, or that we wouldn't want to partner with an MLG or a CPL or whatever for a given event. And we obviously spend a lot of time and a lot of effort on QuakeCon. And kind of the way I've looked at it in the past is that a lot of people run tournaments, and anybody can claim that they're a champion of DreamHack or whatever tournament that, you know, whatever the MLG is doing, whatever the CPL is doing. But it doesn't mean that we necessarily disagree with those guys to sort of have our own tournament. And I've always regarded QuakeCon tournament for our stuff as sort of like the Masters in golf. Doesn't have the biggest purse. It doesn't even have the biggest player field. And it's always at this, you know, always on the same golf course. It doesn't move around like the PGA Tour or the British Open or the US, you know, GA Tour. But it is one that is special because it's the champion there is crowned by id, and you know, to me, especially playing a game like whether it's Quake or whether it's Return to Castle Wolfenstein or any one of those is to sort of be crowned champion by id has a meaning that's almost beyond what it is like winning that tournament. It's, you know, that it's the trophy and the bragging rights, not necessarily, oh well, this is the one that's played at all these other tournaments, etc. So I kind of think we have like a bit of a special case with that, and we do put so much effort into that. It does sort of crowd out our ability to have a lot of attention for other things, but because it's special, I think it's worth it.
Now, I know, looking towards the future, of course, showing off Doom 3 here, no news about what's going to be coming next. Of course, we have Doom 4, maybe hopefully my Quake 5 is coming, or Wolfenstein 2 or something. But now, seeing how everything has gone, and with the single-player focus kind of how it was, and Raid showing off id Tech 5 and the kind of physics that can be done, how does the id Tech 5 lead itself to a multiplayer competitive title? Do you feel like the physics and the way that the game plays will lead it to better opportunities than other engines, and the way that the guns will shoot and kind of how it'll feel?
Well, I think from an id Tech 5 standpoint, the big jump you get there is from a visual standpoint. And for pro gaming, now that means, are they going to turn down the graphical settings so they can, do they feel like they get an additional, you know, frame rate boost or what have you? Although the thing with id Tech 5 is that we can run, you know, high-end graphics on a wide range of systems, whether it's consoles or whether it's a wide range of PC stuff. But there's probably not anything that's like inherent in the id Tech 5 DNA that necessarily lends itself to like, oh, we have all these opportunities with multiplayer. And you know, one of the things that you saw in Rage is that we put multiplayer in, it works great, but you know, it's sort of a different flavor. It's like a multiplayer that's really specific to the Rage universe, which is like, this is just what we decided to do and we thought it was fun. And I think that, you know, I like playing the vehicle deathmatch and the racing and all of that sort of stuff, but it's not necessarily, I think, what you're referring to when you say like, oh well, this is a professional sports, you know, multiplayer implementation. A lot of that really comes more down to what we're doing specifically on the multiplayer side and a lot of specific code to that, not necessarily anything that is like specific to one engine or another. So regardless of what the engine is, I don't think that necessarily means that it's more or less difficult for us to have a compelling multiplayer experience, but it may lend itself to like different points of emphasis within the multiplayer.
And last, before we get you out of here, how do you feel about going forward with multiplayer and with esports and with future titles? How important will that aspect be compared to single player story experience?
Well, I hate to put one against the other, because I think in the best games is you have an excellent multiplayer and you have an excellent single player experience as well. And that's what we've always, you know, strove for, even if it was a big challenge. You know, you don't shy away from the challenge, just try to do your best to do everything that you can to make every aspect of the game that you deliver to be top level of quality. But, you know, really from, as you say, from like a deathmatch experience and from an internet deathmatch experience, I know that id was one of the creators and inventors and trailblazers for that, and so that's a legacy that is not forgotten at this company.
All right, thank you, Todd, and I cannot wait to see what kind of multiplayer coming out of Doom 4.